beginning of this project actually started in Egypt. Here we have a cemetery with hundreds of thousands of burials, not a single name associated with any individual. Who were these people? How are they connected to each other? We don't know, but genetics will allow us to do that. How are they connected to other ancient people? How are they connected to people living today? How are they connected within families inside the cemetery? Those are all questions that can be answered using genetics, and that's what got us started. Got started reconstructing those genealogies in ancient individuals and mummies in Egypt. We realized that in order to do that efficiently, we had to build some sort of template that we can lay this information on top of. And so we went back to Egypt and collected DNA samples from living people and built large maps and connections between those individuals. And then we realized, you know, we can do this not just in ancient Egypt, but we can do it throughout the world. That was the beginning of the technology of bringing this all together and reconstructing genealogies based on DNA. When we know something about how we're connected, that we share a biological relationship, we treat each other differently.
The Sorensen Molecular Genealogy Foundation is to help people know people, not only know themselves, but know how we're all brothers and sisters.
Often we found that when someone tries to trace their genealogy, they find blocks. They've lost written documentation, or perhaps the written documentation didn't exist at all. And when you get to that point, where do you go? What do you do? We know who our parents are, who our grandparents are, who our great-grandparents are, because their information is contained inside of ourselves. If we can unlock that information using the molecular techniques that we've been able to bring together over the last dozen years, we can then reconstruct those genealogies based on the genetic information in addition to the written documentary evidence.
This is accurate. We know how inaccurate the written information is on genealogy. This makes it accurate. Not only makes it accurate, but it takes it to whole new levels. We can go back thousands of years.
Even though all of that molecular information is locked up and we carry it around with us wherever we go, it's difficult to get it out. So what we have to first do is obtain a sample of that DNA.
We are inventing a new system of getting your DNA where we don't have to use blood. It's very, very exciting.
One of the methods that we're using is a cheek swab, where we take a small little swab and just swab the inside of your cheek, take the cells from that to extract the DNA.
It shortens the sequencing process. Our new inventive process is going on right now on how we do DNA.
We have 3 billion bits of information, of genetic information, in each one of our cells. We're not looking at all of that in order to reconstruct these genealogies, but we're only looking at about 250 different parts of that 3 billion bit message of DNA. We compile all of those bits of information together in a large computer program that allows us to correlate all of the genetic signals that we get from an individual with their genealogical histories. The purpose of this research is to compile a database that will be accessible to all of the people of the world, to be able to search that database, to find their genes, to find their gene pools, to find their ancestors. That is the purpose of this project, is to produce that database that will be accessible to the general public, to be able to answer those questions that they have concerning their genealogies. For all the years that I've been associated with this project in molecular genealogy, I haven't found a single individual that's not interested in who he is. Where did he come from? How is he connected to other people? Are we Welsh? Are we Danish? Are we Norwegian? Are we English? Are we German? Are we African? Are we Asian? Where are my roots? Where did I come from? Those are things that we're going to be able to answer for people. Those are the things that we're answering right now for people. There's an interesting little exercise that you can do when you ask the question, how closely are we related to each other? See, you have two parents, and you have four grandparents, and you have eight great-grandparents. And if you go back just 30 generations, there is a potential for 1 billion ancestors. But if you go back 30 generations, you're back, say, 750 years. There's a problem here in that there were not 1 billion people on the Earth 750 years ago. So what does that mean? That means We all married our cousins, I guess. It means we're all related, that we coalesce, that our genealogies collapse down on top of each other. And so we share common ancestors. Doesn't matter, you can take any two people in the world, and someplace back there, they're gonna find genes that they share. Some of our strongest emotions are played out between our relatives, between members of our own family. And that can be for good, can be for bad. I know some fights that I've had with my brothers that I don't know that I'd have with anybody else, but also the love that I have for my brothers is different than anybody, the love that I'd have for anybody else. Likewise, if we can show how closely we are related to each other, it's gonna change the way they feel about each other. In addition to being able to help families, it's amazing to see what it does to an individual. When an individual comes to us not knowing who he is, perhaps he's been adopted, doesn't know who his parents are or his grandparents are, he's floating, he's wondering, where do I fit in? How do I fit in? And be able to answer that question for them. Tell them that this is where you came from. This is your population. This is how you fit in to the rest of the human family. It's amazing how that changes a person's life.
I was born in Auten. I was in Auten at age one and at age two, and then there was a divorce. And with that divorce, my mother remarried. And I was raised by a Nielsen father. He'd been my dad since I was very little. But I had not known anything about these Autens, this Dutch family. One day, I simply wanted to know who these Autens were. We went into Sorensen Research, and with our genealogies in hand, you know, my side was a little bit longer than John Auten's. Both of us, you know, we're looking at several hundred people were watching this just to see what was gonna happen. They did not know there was a connection. And it came back, and according to the research and everything that we had done, there were 15 to 18 generations that would separate him and I. I go back up to this and he would come down here, but you add those all up and there's 15 to 18 generations. And these DNA markers, as they line out, there was not one difference. And this is all in a family I knew nothing about, absolutely nothing about. 2 years ago, I thought so little of family history, and now it's become one of the biggest hobbies that I'm involved in. I found out that there were several boxes at the family farm in Michigan, and that the family farm had been sold. It actually had been inherited by my direct father, and he sold it, but the boxes that contained everything in it, that had the wills, the histories, the newspaper clippings, the formal photographs, the family sittings, all of these were in these boxes. In this box, I found this wallet, and this wallet just melted me, because here's a woman. This is my grandmother's wallet, it's handmade. And I'm looking through this wallet, it is identical as to, she passed away in 69, I believe, 1969. And in this wallet, I found my picture. And I barely remember ever seeing her. I'm not sure that I'd remember her. She remembered me. And I found this wallet with my picture in it. I about melted. I melted because it's somebody I never knew, and somebody who had my picture. I begged for that wallet. I guess it told me that this Ruth Auten loved me, even though I didn't know who she was. I have tried to explain what's happened to my life. Because of relative genetics, because of this study that was done that connected these families, I have family all over the United States, and I've got lists of people that I have now called up. I called aunts who had not heard, knew nothing about me, hadn't seen me since I was a little boy. And I have said, I am Tommy Auten. Where have you been? It's fascinating to know where I actually fit in, who my blood father is. I love the man who raised me. I don't really know the man who didn't, but I've been able to know his family, and it's connected me to a huge family that I did not have before. I have been a Nielsen, but I don't look like them. I don't act like them. I don't think like them. I love them. They've adopted me. They took me in, and my heart's with them. But I look like the Ottens. I talk like the Ottens. I am an Otten.
It's been exciting to be able to be associated with people who have had questions, who've had concerns for a lot of years about who they are and how they're connected, to be able to answer some of those questions for them and see the gratitude actually in their eyes to say, you know, I've been looking for this for years and years and years, and now I know. At the beginning of the Molecular Genealogy Project, we thought that we would have a pretty good handle on how well this was going to perform with 100,000 samples in our database. We're rapidly approaching that benchmark. We're not stopping there. We're going to 500,000, maybe 1,000,000 people. We don't know where the end of the database goes. As that database grows, it's going to reach people throughout the entire world.
To build that database is the crowning jewel, and we think we have a way of doing it. We want to implement that. And we got some great guys around us to make it happen. And not only around us, but these guys that want to make it happen that are around us recognize there's other spirits out there that want to do just as much as they do.
To build the database, we need DNA samples from individuals who have known genealogies, people who know where they came from and how they're connected to other people. We use that information to build the database. Once that database is in place, then it becomes extremely useful. Useful to people who don't know anything about their genealogies. And so now what we do is those people will submit a DNA sample with a specific question. How am I related to this person? Or am I related to this person? Or where do I come from? Where were my genes 50 years ago, 100 years ago, 200 years ago?
People want to do this work, and we want to help them do it. We've got a lot of reasons to want to help them do it.
This project is huge. It's bigger than any one person. It's bigger than any one group. It's bigger than any one academic institution. But we are constantly looking for people who have the same goals, same ideas, same purposes to help us in this project, whether it be another university, whether it be companies, whether it be foundations, whether it be individuals. Anybody who is interested in participating in this project and being able to bring valuable information into this project, funding into this project, whatever it is that they can bring, if they're interested in the same goals, the same vision that we have, we're very interested in cooperating with them. The possibilities of what this project can do for science and understanding questions on inheritance still yet to be unraveled, but also the questions or the things that it can do for society. We really believe that there's something that science can contribute to bringing people together. Families take care of each other. And when you can connect families back together again, it can make a huge difference. Someone out there that may be struggling and needs some help from family, if we've been able to put them back together again, that's a major positive contribution to what's going on in the world. There's something different about this science. Science sometimes seems to be very impersonal. And you're in the laboratory, you're looking at test tubes, you have little tubes of things that you really don't identify with anybody or anything. This project's different. Here we're dealing with people, we're dealing with people's lives, we're dealing with people's families, we're dealing with the connections that people have together. To be able to do that and to think about that as these parts are coming together keeps me getting up every morning.
I've invented many things, had many, many wonderful opportunities. This is the big one.
This project would not be possible without the generosity of Mr. Jim Sorensen. But it's not just his generosity, but it's the vision that he has of his legacy. Something that he can do to leave for the world, some way that he can make a difference in the world, that he can bring the peoples of the world together, understanding how closely they are in fact related.
I know I'm just a grain of sand in a big ocean of people out there. To get any of this thing accomplished, it has to be done with many, many more, many, many more people. But I have the feeling that it'll happen. It'll happen somehow, some way, and I want to be part of that. So I don't want to worry about the glory. I don't want to think about I want to think about inspiring the work to go forward. I want to be there.
We would like to invite people from all over the world to participate in the construction of this database. They can find out more information about how to do that at smgf.org.